say, it just paled by what needed to be said and what will be said a bunch of times about President Bill Bradley. I passed a truck on the way up here that had an interesting bumper strip I wanted to pass along to you. It said, warning, this vehicle may be transporting dangerous political promises. And given the timing of year it is, that's a statement that's never been more true, except more so than usual this time. If I look back at my involvement in politics, it all really started right here in Chapel Hill, in that I had some law professors that were interested in the court reform issue that was going along in the legislature, and it reached the point where there were a small group of us that went over to Raleigh every Monday night to watch the legislature in action. Which some days was pretty good, and some nights it was good and bad. And I just decided when I got out of law school and went back home, I wanted to do something to be a part of that. And I have to admit that the main thing for me personally that came out of that was that I had the distinct feeling that people who were against corporate were either a bunch of thieves and crooks or a bunch of ne'er-do-wells who didn't have anybody's interest in it but their own pocketbook. And much to my amazement, I found that there were lots of intelligent, honest legislators who disagreed with me. And I found that was not the last time that happened during my full terms in the legislature. This is the oldest state university in the country. We keep arguing with Georgia about this because they got their charter from the legislature several years before we got ours. But we got our classes open first, and that's what being a university is teaching. And so I've always thought we had the upper hand. And if you watch the process of the growth of the university from that late 1700s until 1931, you find that there were some changes, but not as much as there were a lot of places. There were land-grant colleges, there were teachers' colleges, there were colleges for African Americans, there were colleges for women, and in Pembroke we had the first all-Indian school in the country. And as we have seen the last couple of years, however, money does drive a lot of things. In 1931, Governor Max Gardner, who a lot of people think was one of our veterans, faced a similar budget crisis. And he just did a lot of changing because of that. And in that period of time, over the next 30 years, World War II came along, they had the GI Bill. You had a board of trustees from the university, and Governor Gardner had included within the university at that point what was then Woman's College, became UNCG later, and NC State in Raleigh. I'll tell you a little bit more about those later. But in 1956, perhaps the single most important thing that happened to the university in this 20th century took place when Bill Friday was named as president of the university. That covers a lot of territory. And I think if he were here, he'd probably say the same thing I do about some of my life. That timing is very often the key to everything, and it doesn't hurt to have a little luck. But he had the most interesting set of problems to deal with in his 30-year stretch as president. And it started with something that probably most of you may not even know what it is, but it is a big time feeling about athletic teams. We've heard a little bit about those since I've been up here too. But the Dixie Classic was hosted by North Carolina, NC State, Duke, and Wake Forest every year in Raleigh. They invited four outside teams from all parts of the country. It was sort of like the ACC versus the world. Until a scandal broke in the New York Times involving First City College of New York and NYU. Then it started spreading out into Fisher and reached the ACC, well, what was in the Southern College. And President Friday talked with the chancellors and did something. I've often asked myself if I would have the nerve and the courage to do it, but he closed down the Dixie Classic. And it just broke the hearts of a lot of us. So when I went to the legislature in 63, I was one of those that was right on board when the resolution was introduced in the House to reinstate the Dixie Classic. It wasn't a binding law or anything, it was just a recommendation. The House had 120 members and 111 had signed the resolution. And that's when I found out early on just what a really, really good politician Bill Friday was. The bill never got out of committee, even though it had 11 out of 12 legislators who had sponsored it. And that told me a lot that I've never forgot my whole life about just sheer political savvy. Now, the 60s were a pretty interesting time to be around in North Carolina. Every session that came along in the legislature, somebody wanted to change their name or become part of this school or part of that school. And there were just literally no sessions that went smoothly. It was just really hard work. And if you don't think a name change can be tough, try getting through the legislature even now. NC State, the University of North Carolina, Raleigh. The state fans did not think well of that. And when you start taking the word woman out of women's college and making it UNCG, we had a lot of female constituents that weren't very happy about that either. Regional universities sprang up. I had one in my hometown up at Appalachia. And there were several others. And it was a real good chance to make enemies just overnight. And so, You also had some city colleges that sprang up. Charlotte, Nashville, and Wilmington had been municipal colleges, and all those became part of the university. The School of the Arts came along. Not necessarily as part of this movement that was going on. It was mostly Terry Sanford and Mary Seaman from over Durham who really wanted it, so they put up the money. And that answers a lot of questions right there. And the letter of the School for Math and Science over Durham was added to the university. And there were all sorts of coalitions and priorities within the General Assembly. I got to see it firsthand. I was on the board of the Appropriations Committee every time and was part of a group that was trying to help Appalachian. You swapped your vote for somebody who was down in East Carolina or something. And eventually you went home with a fair amount of money for your school. And it became more apparent that this was not working the way it was supposed to. If the idea was to spend the money in the best way possible for the education of the kids in North Carolina. Now, Governor Bob Scott was the son of a governor, came in, he had been the lieutenant governor. He was chairman of the Board of Higher Education, handled a whole bunch of schools, and then he was also chairman of the Board of Trustees for the university. So he's in a good strategic position to try to do some things about that. And Governor Scott appointed Lindsey Warren from down at Goldsboro, who is one of the best legislators that our state has been privileged to have. To put together a report recommending what to do about the problem. And from the time that report came in, it had more intense debate than anything else I had seen during my term there, even more than the Equal Rights Amendment when it was on the ballot as a constitutional thing. Not always on the floor, but in the hallways, in the committee rooms, and on the telephone. And you would be pretty lucky if you finished each day without somebody being mad with you. It almost always wasn't the same people that were mad the day before. Mm-hmm. That's just how fast and changed it moved. It got to be a very important issue whether the board was going to be created, which is the Board of Governors, was going to be a coordinating board or a governing board. How big it was going to be, because the UNC Board of Trustees had 100 people on it, which means if you were legislator under a life or a time, you were really mud. Just didn't amount to much. But they had a 12-person executive committee that made most of the decisions. And in July 1, 1972, you had to have the new administration in place and all the policies in place that you were going to operate on. And Bill Friday has won the battle of how the legislation was going to be set up, but you could still lose the war if you didn't get the policies right. And it was all done very quietly, without a minimum of publicity about it. Of course, newspapers then weren't quite as nosy as they are today. And right now, whatever cause you're on, whose side you're on, you've got all these 16 schools being assimilated into one organization. You've got pulling and tugging by people who are on there who have been graduates of East Carolina or Charlotte or wherever, and you had to try to break their loyalties away from their alma mater and get them thinking about loyalties to the system. And this is a big part of where I think Bill Friday just pulled off a major miracle that's still serving the people of the state. And while that's going on, we're also fighting that, and over here we're fighting HEW. It's Health, Education, and Welfare in Washington, overseeing that our policies are racially unfair. And it was ironic in a way that Bill Friday was the one defending. And in terms of the principle of equality and fairness, he was in there with the champions. But he also believed that the federal government shouldn't be allowed to write the rules for how you run a university. And history's proven him right time and again on that. And finally got it heard by a federal judge in North Carolina, who, even though he's on for life, I guess knew he was going to live in North Carolina the rest of his life. So he threw out HEW, and things have been doing better ever since. All of this about the structure of our university has been unique, I think, to North Carolina. There were an awful lot of people around the country who didn't think it would work. And today, many of those are still shaking their heads and not able to figure out why. And I think you can point the finger clearly at President Bill Frank and his staff. I hate to throw in staff at John sitting here, but he had a great group of people around him who knew how to work the legislature, but who also knew how to work the campuses. And you how to say things in a way that people in North Carolina said, that sounds reasonable. And that's half the battle right there. I've always believed that this university is what puts North Carolina apart and above the rest of the South and most of the rest of the country. And I've said nothing that has changed my mind. It's ironic that you have to also give credit to Governor Scott, even though he and President Friday were on opposite sides of town. He had that old stubborn streak that the Scott family had, and he just hung in there and kept fighting, and eventually it came around to where everybody thought it was all right. And I have to say, you have to give credit to the legislature. Because, you know, when you're sitting over there in the legislature and you've gotten yourself elected out of vote back home, you liable to think you know it all. I got disabused of that early on, too. My first day in the legislature, one day over, legislators called me up and said, "Son, would you take this bill up to the reading clerk? He thought I was a page." And I looked about that young man at the time. But for those of us who cared and paid attention, this was a chance of a lifetime to be part of creating something that going to be great and lifting to our state, to a whole different point of view. Structure does matter.